only a world. We are having the thing in us. We need not believe in the word God. We need not believe that there is a God. We still believe that we are living. The very consciousness that we are living is the only required thing. And that consciousness is called God by somebody. Why are you bothered about the term God? You may deny God, you can. You need not accept that there is God. But you cannot deny to accept that you are existing. How do you know? Can I know the person who questioned this? Yourself? Excuse me. How do you know that you are here? That power of knowledge is called God by somebody. Understand? If you don't want to call it by the name God, you can call it by any other name. You can call it as I am. It is all right. There's no trouble in it. So, God is not a troubling being. We may accept the word God, we may not accept the word God, but the thing is there in us. How can you, out of a simple talk with people, tell them their future? For you, it may be a simple talk, but for me, it is a sacred purpose. Talking to anyone is a very sacred mission to me. To you, it may be a simple thing. So, we all sit in a classroom. Some people receive the lesson very beautifully, very detailed. Some people will escape the lesson because they are less attentive. The same thing. I am more attentive to you than I am talking to you. Because I feel that all human beings are sacred. They are images of the wonderful creation of nature. Nature is creating our bodies, our minds, and all these things. I sincerely believe that every human being is a very, very valuable specimen created by nature, from nature. Therefore, I examine every part of it. I will be attentive to every question, every gesture, every posture, every smile, every look, every shape, every line on your face, every eyebrow, every wink, every doing this thing, that thing, all these things give me a fund of knowledge about your past, present and future. Satisfied? Doesn't your spirit come to the point when it has developed so much, so it does not need any body and then doesn't need to be reincarnated anymore? A very scientific question. Can I know the person who has put it?
Who asked the question?
Who asked this question? Yourself? Very good. Yes. There is a stage in human evolution when we no more require a physical body to live. We can live without a physical body and without the burden of a physical body. There is a point, and those persons who have come to that stage, they will return from this earth planet to a higher planet for a higher evolution, because this earth is only one step of evolution. Up to certain stage of evolution, we will be here on this earth. Afterwards, we take the form of a ray of light of some color of the spectrum. We go to another planet. There is a choice. We may go either to the planet Mercury, or planet Venus, or planet Jupiter. Then we will have the further step of our evolution, then from those planets, we will return to the same source, that is the sun. But we will not remain there. From sun, we come down to the planets. As an intelligence, a ray of intelligence, that is what we are calling the sun's rays and the spectroscopy. What we call the sun's rays are only the intelligences very, very highly evolved and have crossed all these stages of our present evolution. Is it clear? But on this earth also, there are some beings who want to still live on this earth even after they have arrived that stage of evolution. For them, to have a body is a matter of choice. Out of their sweet will, they take bodies and come to earth to live with us so that they may help us to further our evolution. Those people are called masters, saints, and lords, and incarnations of God. Satisfied? Do you believe in predestination? I do not believe in predestination. But who has questioned this, please? I never believe predestination, but I believe a pre-planning. Do you like to plan your things for tomorrow? Yes, because it is a matter of convenience. So, the nature of this earth has its own pre-planning for us. That we may call predestination. In winter, it will be very chill. In the next winter also, it will be very chill. If you call it predestination, it is wrong. You can call it the cycle of seasons, that is, the plan of nature. By understanding the plan of nature, you can know some immediate future. When I question you, are you going to excursion tomorrow? You can tell me yes or no. Is it predestination? No, it is only an understanding or a pre-planning of tomorrow and knowing the plan of tomorrow. When we have our tomorrow and our planning, the earth has its tomorrow and its planning, and the span of its tomorrow is thousands and thousands of years. We need not call it predestination. We can call it the plan of this earth. Satisfied? Yes. In our meditation, I gave a recital of a passage from the Vedic scriptures. Our respected madam asks me to give out the import of that passage in a brief manner. I try to do it. That passage or mantra is taken from the Vedas. The sacred books or the scriptures of India are called Vedas. Veda. There are four volumes of the Vedas, and the first volume is called Rig Veda. Means the science of the externalization of light. Rig means light. Rig Veda means the science of the brilliance of the light. From that this passage is taken. It describes that in space there will be globes of space separating. Understand? Just as we have whirlpools of water in water. In flowing water we have whirlpools of water. So also in space from time to time there will be globes of space which become active. These globes will become active and give out the solar systems. That is the beginning of the solar system. Each sun of the solar system gives out its planets. Each planet gives out its own atoms. Each atom undergoes its own evolution. and each atom becomes a soul or a consciousness, and each consciousness becomes an individual, each individual becomes a personality, each personality becomes the universal consciousness once again. So from space to a globe of space, from globe of space again to the nature of the original space. It is in this mantra, it is compared that the space is like a big bird, and this globe is like the egg of that bird. Egg. Bird laying eggs, and the egg will be burst, and again there will be the same pattern of the bird. That is the chief import of this mantra. Of course, there is much to explain, but it takes a very, very long time. The chief content of the mantra is the description of this egg from space and the evolution of the solar systems from the egg, and the evolution of the planets from the solar systems, the evolution of the atoms from the planets, evolution of the individuals from the atoms, personalities from individuals, souls from personalities, and again the consciousness unbound from souls. That is the rough import or the chief import. If anyone is interested, I can get it translated into English, into lucid, non-technical English, and send it to our madam if anyone is interested, with an explanation and a comment. A few words. I wish all of you good success and prosperity, and above all, happiness, which is the birthright of every living being. I wish you all to be happy in life, to know how to be happy, to remove the obstacles for happiness. That is real wisdom. I feel very much indebted to this institution, to you all students, and above all to our host, the mistress of this school. She has given me much happiness by presenting all of you here and presenting herself to me. I have enjoyed your company immensely, and I do strongly believe that an acquaintance or a contact made once is a contact made permanently. Whether we can meet again in our life or not, the contact never goes. So I have your contact with you permanently, and I wish you have my contact with you permanently. God bless you. I have the privilege to speak a few words about the essence of my experience in teaching. And at first I am proud to express that I started my career as a teacher. I found that my interest in it was growing day by day, and now after so many years I find that the teaching is the best profession that a man can have, and it also gives us a better opportunity to get ourselves evolved very quickly. The first thing I believed and I believe is that a teacher is of two kinds. There are two ways of teaching according to my experience. One is imparting knowledge, which is the unimportant side of teaching. Second is inducing more life, that is the more important side of it. Just as we use the language only as a vehicle, The ideal teacher uses knowledge also only as a vehicle, not an end by itself. That's the more important side of teaching. T. First type of teaching is to impart what we know to the student. It uses the capacity to have a rearrangement in ourselves of the known facts. In course of time, we will know the subject better by teaching. And also, the capacity to reason out, rearrange and plan things will grow gradually in a conscientious teacher. As a teacher, if you are conscious of your mission, you will find that your capacities of giving the relative importance of the items of your knowledge will grow. With it, the capacities to plan your daily life and the routine throughout the year and throughout the life also will follow. That's the most important side. This, the subjective growth of the teacher, as it is understood by me, is very, very interesting. The teacher grows into a master. This is the only profession which gives us that opportunity. Because the psychology of man is nothing but a mirror of the higher psychology of man or the inner man. Whatever we do only in reflection, in the mirror. The more we try to explain, the more we get ourselves explained to the subject. The more we try to make others understand, the more we understand for ourselves, the subject as well as the other person. So, it is all a play with a big mirror, looking glass, like this. If we eliminate the zero error of lateral inversion, in mirror also you will find lateral inversion. If you hold the book like this, you will see the letters in the mirror, but they undergo an inversion. So also, our psychological values undergo a lateral inversion in students. If we can filter that inversion before they reach the student, they will receive the same image as we receive. So, the teacher in the beginning years of his career will allow the students to suffer from the lateral inversion of his work. That is, the more he tries to impose his own belief on the student, the less student begins to believe him. The more you try to impose your personality upon the student, the less will be the impression on the student about you. A teacher who is very conscious of imposing an impression will have a very poor impression in the minds of the student. That is the lateral inversion. And before we begin to give something valuable to the student, we should be able to filter that impression and then give only the correct impression. Then how to filter it is to interlude a sheet of intellectual filter paper between your mind and the mind of the student. What is that filter paper? It is the realization that you are not imparting knowledge, but you are inducing knowledge. That is the filter paper. Because in this world, nobody is going to believe because you are believing a certain thing. That is the fundamental fact. I believe a certain thing. I can never make you believe through reason or argument or any amount of psychological experiments. Because the psychology of man is only superficial and the inner man is beyond all psychology. All the psychological faculties of man are only the waves in a ocean, whereas the ocean is quite different from the waves. Even though you convince a person, one who is convinced against his will believes in the older things still. That is the truth of it. Through logic, you can make him accept, you can convince him, but on the receiving apparatus, the acceptance and the level of being convinced are only superficial layers. Belief is the innermost layer, and always it comes from within outside, not from outside. That is one fundamental truth about teaching. You can make a man better believe what he already believes. You can purify the belief of a person. You can help a person to believe clearly, more understandably and more reasonably what he already believes. Or you can clarify a person about what he believes hazily, indefinitely, or what he wants to believe, or what he suspects to have something in his mind. That is the whole thing about it. Second truth is, all the subjects we teach to the students, they are all superficial. Let it be language, let it be chemistry, physics, biology, philosophy, whatever it may be. All the knowledge in this world is only temporary. It may look strange, but you know that all these letters are only representatives. They are like the keyboard of a typewriter. They, by themselves, they mean nothing. They convey something. They are only like worksmen on the street. So, by themselves, no letter of the alphabet means anything. So also, no word by itself means anything. No paragraph, no book, no subject. All the subjects that a man learns, they are like the alphabet of his personality. They convey something, by themselves they have no value at all. I think you appreciate it. If at all there is anything that you don't feel it correct, you please tell me. All these subjects by themselves have no value. That which is valuable is life itself and nothing else. And for that, all these subjects form their own alphabet. They may be sacred alphabet, I don't deny. The more important the science is, the more important the subject it is, the more sacred purpose it may serve only in conveying. The teacher should remember this, and that he should also remember that he is dealing with a subject of secondary importance, whatever he is teaching. Primary importance is the only one subject, which is contained in only one book, that is the student himself. The student is the subject, that is for him to learn. The teacher is the subject which the teacher learns from. It is the only subject which is really useful, and all the subjects form the alphabet. So it is the sacred purpose of a teacher to be conscious of the undercurrent of the most important subject, that is the consciousness of the student. It is very delicate, and the surface layers are very much involved and intricate. All the layers of intellect, intuition, emotion, instinct, all these layers are very, very intricate. Every man by birth, every man or every woman by birth has these layers very well arranged in a perfect and beautiful order. We are at liberty to tackle with them, but once tackled, your mind is already tackled for that life. It can never be a fresh mind. Once rightly tackled, it will be for that life a mind rightly tackled. It can never be disturbed. The teacher can tackle the mind of a student once for the first time in a right path. It takes no time. It takes only a few days at times a few weeks, and sometimes a few months, and not more than that. Then you leave the student to any part of the world. He can never be disturbed, either in the outer layers or the inner layers, by any evil force. Similarly, if for the first time the student's mechanism is wrongly tackled, it is for life tackled. It cannot be tackled in the right way. One of the psychological facts is that we have to bear in mind is a fresh mind is a virgin mind. A fresh mind, after having a picture of a mother, for example, when he reads a book of crime, when he visualizes a picture of a cruel murder, the picture is there on the mind, and it is not at all a fresh mind after that picture. Suppose you make him forget. After 20 years, after 30 years, if he reads the same book with the same picture, he will receive the book and the picture with less resistance than he had received for the first time. So, the receiving of evil for the first time is more difficult than it receives for a second time. Even you erase totally from the memory of the student any evil effect, it is a mind from which evil is erased, but it is not a mind where evil is not printed. There is that difference. So a virgin mind is a virgin mind. A mind once tackled is a mind once tackled for life, because only death can give the purification of the mind again into a virgin state in the next reincarnation. If we bear this in our mind, we know the sanctity of creating an impression upon the mind of a student. Creating an impression is creative work. Teaching is a constructive work, which is a secondary work. Teaching is not creation. Creation is creating an impression. Teaching is giving, conveying some information. To create an impression, you should be a creator. To teach some subject, you should be a good businessman in the transactions of knowledge. That is, known some known facts in your mind as some goods to have a good exchange with the student. That's all. It is all of some market value. It's a lot of difference. Creating means bringing out from the student what he was having as his innate tendencies. The last and final effort of a teacher should be that he should bring out what is there, that is good, that is positive, that is creative in the student, and consciously ignore what is there that is not creative in him. Because the more you feel conscious of it, and the more you try to draw his attention towards it, the more he will dwell in the evil and it will be magnified. So the term to forgive is divine is more important than it appears to be. In the mundane world of affairs, it may be an ordinary phrase to forgive is divine, but in the spiritual sense of what we are doing with the student, to forgive is divine is something of a very, very deep importance. If you stimulate the student about something which he already knows, and among that something, that which is only good, what you believe good, and leave him away without touching the other side of it, that is the best way of tackling the student. In the first years, fresh years of studenthood, if you suggest him only things that are very, very good, things that the student feels that, yes, this is my good point, things that he is convinced, then he gets into the habit of magnifying them. After 1 year or 2 years, even though any amount of suggestion is made in the negative way, it doesn't have any effect, because the mind is already occupied by the stimulation created the first time. That is how I feel after so many years of teaching. Of course, I too teach languages in my university like this. I am a professor in Oriental languages in the Andhra University. I too teach only languages and their significance and the literatures therein. So I feel I have more affinity with you in our work. I understood that language is only a pious vehicle. So also I understood that whatever subject we teach him is only a vehicle for his better living and a higher and more realized living. In that way, it is pious. We need not dump the student with the technical terms and the jargon of any sacred subject. For example, meditation. We need not use the word meditation with the student, because he may feel something arbitrary and some nonsense about it. Or God, or spiritualism. These terms, they carry much of unnecessary impression about them, because they are much misused on the street by many people. They have a good sense, but they also have the common ordinary way of sense, because they are used by many more people than that is required. So it is more psychological for us to tackle the subjects without the technical terms, practical subjects. Even in the case of science, scientific subjects also, it is better to introduce the unity of the subject to the student, eliminating the technical terms in the first step. Then, after he gets the synthesis of the subject, you can give him all the technical terms, he will remember them very easily. But generally what they do in the universities is, in the schools is, that in any subject, they will begin with the teaching of the technical terms. What happens, it is most encyclopedic. The student begins to feel that he is overburdened with the more number of terms to memorize. So his learning begins with memorizing, and the result is he will be only a computer and not a creator. After 10 years or 12 years of learning through memorizing, the pious machine of the human brain begins to lose its acquaintance with his creative faculty and begins to develop into a computer. So as far as possible, we should try to eliminate this burden of technical terms in the first step. When the unity of any subject is attained by a student, then it is easy for him to remember all the technical terms, because he need not have any effort to memorize or remember. For example, chemistry. People begin with these symbols, science, formula, equations and all these things. So in India, there is a method of getting the student by heart the multiplication table. It's very, very bad. Instead of doing it, you narrate the subject to him without technical terms. It is very easy. For us also it is very easy. You narrate him the subject. He learns the subject like a story. Again, ask him to narrate it. He will narrate it. Second step, narrate him some more detail. So, from synthesis to analysis is the proper method of teaching. Not from the detail to the subject, but from the outline of the subject to the detail. That is the proper way. Give only a few details in the beginning. You remember how we learn things from nature, from our childhood? If you just recollect how we began to grow, you will understand the most psychological method of teaching. That is the only good part of it. The detail, giving the detail, is only the result of the vanity of the teacher to show that he is a great scholar. So, don't start with the detail. If we want to appear that we know so many things, that is too bad to the mind of the student. It is not what you know that the student wants, but what he wants you should know. The new teacher is bothered of conveying what he knows, but the experienced teacher knows what the student wants, not what he knows. This is the key to final success from the point of view of the student as well as the teacher. And I feel once again that I am at home with you all. I very much thank you to have given this patient hearance. Though you know all these things, it is only in a way to make my contact more familiarized with you that I pretend to have given some speech. That's all. Thank you all.